Let's get started. This first unit, recalling some basic concepts regarding the acid and base properties of chemical compounds, which will be extremely useful to understand all topics covered in this course. Even though we had not even studied chemistry, everybody had been familiar with an acid and base means because they are present in our lives. The fruit juice, baking soda, ammonia, vinegar, or the acid naturally produced by our stomach, they are only a few examples of substances in our lives with acid or base properties. Even though we had not even studied chemistry, everybody had been familiar with what an acid or a base means because they are present in our lives. By their presence in our lives is beyond the products available in our local grocery, because they are the key ingredients in the chemical industry. A German chemist, Justus von Liebig, commented that the wealth of a nation could be judged from the amount of sulfuric acid it consumes. Human uses of acid and bases have been known since the antiquity. For example, the word acid derives from the Latin term acidus, which means sour or tart, while a base is something that tastes bitter. Later on time, in 1779, Antoine Lavoisier, which is considered the father of modern chemistry, believed that acidity was caused by the presence of oxygen in a compound. In fact, oxygen means acid former, which is really curious, because now we know that this is completely wrong, although the element preserves its name. Some years later, in 1810, a British chemist, Humphrey Davy, demonstrated that oxygen was not present in many acids, but it was hydrogen, the element which was present in all acids. It was Svante Arrhenius who, in 1884, while he was working on the conductivity of electrolyte, when he proposed a new definition for acid and base. According to Arrhenius, an acid is a substance that dissociates in water, producing hydrogen ions, H+, in solution. Similarly, he proposed that a base is a substance that ionizes in water to give the hydroxide ion OH-. Some simple examples of Arrhenius' acid and base substance will be hydrochloric acid or sodium hydroxide. So when hydrochloric acid is bubbled in water, the concentration of hydrogen ions increase due to the HCl dissociation, and if we dissolve sodium hydroxide in water, it gives a sodium ion and hydroxide ion. Additionally, when an Arrhenius acid and an Arrhenius base are brought together, they generate water in a process that is called neutralization. Arrhenius' theory was accepted for about 3 decades. But finally, some limitations were detected, and it was observed that this served well for a limited use. For example, this theory was unable to explain the well-known basicity of ammonia. It was in 1923 when this fact was explained by Brosset in Denmark and Lowry in UK independently, who announced the broader definition of an acid and a base. From the point of view of this theory, an acid is a substance which is a proton donor, while a base is a proton acceptor. This definition, unlike Arrhenius, are not limited to water solution. So, according to Brosset-Lowry theory, an acid-base reaction involves the transfer of one hydrogen ion from one substance to another one. So they are viewed as a proton transfer reaction. In that reaction, the diprotonated acid becomes what is known as the conjugate base, while the protonated base becomes the conjugate acid. Acid of base and their conjugate are associated with one another, and in what is called the conjugate pair. This new Brosset-Lowry approach solved the problem we found in order to explain the basicity of ammonia with Arrhenius' theory. Ammonia acts as a base, drawing up hydrogen ions from water, which act as proton donor to generate ammonium ion and hydroxide ions. But water is able to act as a proton acceptor too, for example, in front of hydrochloric acid to generate the hydronium ion, which is the preferred name, axoxide anion, according to the new IUPAC recommendation. The ability of a substance to act as a base or as an acid
as we have seen with water, is defined as amphiprotic behavior. So water can react with itself. One molecule will act like an acid, and the other one like a base, to form an oxidanium and hydroxide ion. The extent of this reaction, known as self-dissociation reaction, is very minimal, and the equilibrium constant for this particular reaction, we have the special symbol Kw, and its name as ion product constant, have a low value of 1 times to 10 to the minus 14, at 25 Celsius degree. Pure water only contains oxidanion and hydroxide ions, and according to the stoichiometry, an equal number of both ions must be present. So we can deduce that in pure liquid water, in equilibrium, the concentration of oxidanion and hydroxide ions are equal to 1 times to 10 to the minus 7 and 25 Celsius degree. In general, a solution that has equal concentration of oxidanion and hydroxide ions, it is said to be neutral. When a solution contains more hydrogen ions than hydroxide ions, it will be an acidic solution. While the amount of hydroxide is larger than the oxidanion ions, the solution is considered as a basic or alkaline solution. In 1909, Danish biochemist Søren Sørensen proposed the term of pH that allows us to represent the concentration of hydronium ions in a more concise way. The operator P is the negative value of the logarithm of the concentration of oxidanion ions. In this sense, an acidic solution which contains a higher concentration of oxidanion ions will have a lower value of pH, less than 7, while an alkaline solution will have a higher value of pH. In the same way, Sørensen defined pOH as minus logarithm of the concentration of hydroxide ions. If we take logarithm of the expression of the constant of equilibrium of water, we observe that the sum of pH and pOH will be constant and equal to 14 at 25 Celsius degree. Therefore, different values of pH will reflect the different acidity or basicity of a solution. So the lower the pH, the greater the concentration of oxidanion ions, and the more oxidation ions are generated by the acidic solution, the stronger is the acid. Then, not all the acid or base generate in solution the same amount of oxidanion and hydroxide ions. It depends on the strength of the acid. A strong acid, like hydrochloric acid, is completely dissociated in water. So one molar solution of HCl will lead to one molar concentration of H+. Thus, the equilibrium will lie very much to the right, while the reverse reaction will occur to a very small extent. The chloride ion is a weak base with a low tendency to gain protons. But it's not always the case. There is some other acid, like acetic acid, that are partially dissociated in water. For example, a 1 molar solution of acetic acid is only 0.4% dissociated. It has less tendency to lose proton and is therefore a much weaker acid. We can write the expression for the equilibrium constant for the dissociation reaction of acetic acid in water, and that constant is called acid dissociation constant, and that is determined to be 1.A times 10 to the minus 5. This small value indicates that the equilibrium will lie mostly towards the left. So the acetate ion is much stronger base than chloride ion, due to the acetic acid is a weaker acid than hydrochloric acid. We can conclude that as Ka decreases, Kv for the conjugate base must increase, or said in other words, the weaker an acid, the stronger the conjugate base. Weaker acid and base have a small constant value, lower than 1, and usually we use, in the same way we define pH, the term pKa, that is defined as the minus logarithm of Ka. So the greater the value of pKa, the lower will be the strain of the acid. But the Bruster-Lowry theory was not capable to interpret the acidity of molecules such as boron 3 fluoride or aluminum 3 chloride. So a more general definition of acids at base was necessary. It was in 1923 when G.N. Lewis defined an acid as a substance that accepts a pair of electrons, and a base, a substance that donates electrons. The neutralization reaction in that case between the molecule that donates the electron from a filled orbital to the molecule that accepts this electron in an empty orbital conduces to a form a covalent bond. This definition is broader and is not restricted to solution. A good example of this kind of reaction will be the employment of lime in stat gas scrubbers to reduce the emission of CO2 generated in coal-fired power plants. This is important for the environment due to the fact that sulfur dioxide eventually becomes in sulfuric acid, which is readily absorbed by the rain, so this is responsible for what is called the acid rain. This reaction is a good example about how acid-base reaction can occur between all the states of matter.